Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Military Strategy, A Global History by Jeremy Black. Narrated by Matthew Waterson. Preface. Strategy, an overarching vision of what an organization or individual wants to achieve, coupled with a set of objectives designed to make that possible, is not the details of the plans by which goals are implemented by military means. Instead, strategy is the ways by which nations, states, rulers, elites, and others seek to shape their situation, producing international and domestic systems and pursuing outcomes that provide security and that safeguard and advance interests. The key element and the crucial context are the contest for power and at every level. This is the case for strategy as both goals and means, and indeed for strategy in both goals and means. These are phenomena that in practice, despite efforts to dissect them for analytical purposes, are rarely as separate as envisaged. Moreover, power takes different forms, has varied uses, and is not understood in a uniform fashion. This is true of the character and use of military power, as well as of other types of power. In assessing strategy and strategic culture, it is necessary, if focusing solely on military strategy, to consider how states, or rather their elites and leaderships, seeking to maintain and increase power, pursue internal as well as external agendas, and do so knowing that it will make them better able to obtain goals and to wage war. The relationship between the two agendas, internal and external, is important, and also affects both. They cannot be readily separated. Linked to this were, and are, the perennial questions of who directed strategy, however defined, and to what ends. The latter question affects the evaluation of both competence and success. Indeed, any strategy is contingent on complex contexts, both international and domestic, short and long term, and has no optimum dimensions. Moreover, the people who direct strategy are not always the same as those who evaluated success. One of the major problems in executing strategy is for decision makers at that level to convince those who frame the criteria of success that they are doing the right thing and doing it well. Any focus on ruling individuals and groups helps explain why the later matrix frequently adopted for military strategy, that of the general staffs which developed from the late 19th century, a matrix that helped drive the process of defining strategy, is not, however, readily or sensibly applicable to much of history. And, as a separate issue, possibly not so today either. A focus not on general staffs, but instead on the royal court context of the long earlier period of human history ironically also directs attention to reconsidering strategy during the last quarter millennium, the period when the word has been used and the concept developed. In particular, leaders over the last quarter millennium, including to the present, frequently operated in a fashion that would not have been out of character, or indeed context, for their predecessors who presided over these courts. Thus, there are elements of decision-making under Napoleon, Hitler, Putin, and Trump that would not have been totally out of place for Louis XIV of France. In many cases, irrespective of whether the comparison across time was longer or shorter, it was deliberately sought, as with Benito Mussolini, Italy's fascist dictator from 1922 to 1943, and his repeated attempt to strike a resonance using explicit reference to the founding Roman Emperor, Augustus Caesar, who ruled 19 centuries earlier. This continuity is more especially the case if the focus is on strategic culture or strategic process, rather than strategic content, especially in the case of specific military means or the broader international context. In particular, there is the question of how far gloire, the search for prestige, and the use of the resulting reputation to secure international and domestic goals are, while important for all, especially attractive and important in monarchical or pseudo-monarchical systems. Indeed, providing them in many respects with their prime strategic purpose, tone, and drive. This approach towards strategy understandably works in a diachronic fashion. In other words, across time. However much the latter approach may appear surprising in a subject, military history, that focuses so much on technological change and thus the immediate context, with time as non-diachronic. An emphasis on the value of prestige and reputation adopts a cultural functionalism based on their value that is linked to a psychological approach to image and competition. In part, a competition for prestige can enhance all the powers involved. More commonly, however, the competition was necessarily at the expense of other powers, and was very much desired and affirmed in these terms. The situation has continued to the present. The rhetorical character that is part of strategy's essentially political nature should also attract attention. Separately, so also should the frequent fluidity of strategy, or rather of the alliances involved, and in contrast, the fixedness of particular plans. Focusing on the latter and on their genesis can lead to an underplaying of the former. Conversely, plans can change more rapidly. None of these characteristics, however, necessarily appeals to those seeking a science of strategy and or a set of lessons that allegedly can be readily learned, and the teaching of which provides them with point, position, and profit. Strategy is a term much debated now and in recent years. Indeed, in the West, helping both to provoke and to focus or refocus this debate, there is a sense that strategy is in some way a lost art, and there is a much repeated argument to that effect. This sense reflects a crisis of confidence, notably in Britain but also in the United States, as a result of repeated setbacks, or at least serious difficulties, for Western forces in Iraq and Afghanistan in the 2000s and 2010s, and the linked problems for Western goals. The rhetoric and associated disquiet about absent or flawed strategy and about a confusion of policy and strategy rose even more in the mid and late 2010s. This was specifically in response to the general imbroglio concerning Western policy towards Syria and indeed the Middle East as a whole. The House of Commons Foreign Affairs Committee referred in 2016 to the failure to develop a coherent Libya strategy. In part, there is the loss of the ability to determine and maintain plausible goals, which then leads to an inability to formulate effective strategy, let alone the problems with individual strategies. The rhetoric and disquiet about strategy also reflected a more general concern in the West in the 2000s and 2010s about drift. This was drift in the case of the conception and implementation of what was variously described as policy and strategy, and that referred variously to goals and implementation. The confused and largely unsuccessful response to Chinese and Russian assertion and expansionism was an aspect of this disquiet. Anxiety about President Donald Trump's attitudes and policies, notably his hostility to multilateralism and to many of the institutions involved, including NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and the WTO, World Trade Organization, was a major issue in 2017-19. Earlier, there had been very different, but nevertheless also pressing and repeated anxieties about the strategic grasp of Presidents Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, and Barack Obama, anxieties that tended to be forgotten when the focus was on President Trump. In this context of concern and of the response to concern, the term strategy was much employed in the 2000s and 2010s, and not always in an illuminating fashion. That itself was an instructive comment on the vocabulary of strategy and its role in politics, variously the politics of policymaking and the public politics of contestation. In both, the use of strategy served rhetorical and political purposes, and although generally in different ways, these purposes also affected the use of the term within the military and among academic commentators. The extent to which commentators focused on differences and tensions arising from contrasting goals between the powers, notably China and Russia on the one hand, and the Western powers on the other, and indeed among the Western powers, was also an instructive comment on the vocabulary of strategy. These contrasts underlined the extent to which alliances and would-be alliances entailed commitments and possibilities in terms of goals and means that involved the pressures and problems of cooperation. To offer any account of strategy as a military activity that does not take adequate note of the international context, its role as an independent variable and its consequences is evidently flawed. There's no reason why the same should not be the case for the past. Indeed, the use of the present to guide and equip questions and thoughts about the past is an integral aspect of assessing the historical dimension of strategy. Modern terms, such as strategy or geopolitics, are employed to provide a 21st century appraisal of what happened. As long as ahistorical perspectives are avoided, this is a rewarding approach and, in practice, a necessary one. Conversely, military history might be employed to ascertain and define lessons from the past for the present, and can be justified in these terms within the military. However, the process of lesson learning, notably the understanding of this history and the search for lessons, tends very much to be approached in current terms, and this can be misleading. This present-centered characteristic is reflected in different editions of particular studies. This book proceeds from an introduction through a series of case studies of states, periods, and conflicts to a conclusion. The case studies are contextualized in terms of shifts across the last six centuries. Much of the book will be devoted to those case studies. Linked to this, there will be a discussion of strategic culture and practice, and, specifically, of the degree to which it is appropriate to use the terms of strategy. The case studies are chosen to illustrate the range of strategy and also to draw attention to key issues, notably the changing nature and importance of strategic culture. This is a book about the reality of strategy, and in particular, strategic decision-making. Its practice in the past, the present, and very likely the future. Much of current writing on strategy, in contrast, deals with the strategic thought of leading thinkers, such as Sun Tzu, Clausewitz, and Mahan. While engaging with aspects of this thought, I propose to focus on the strategic practice of leading military figures over the past four centuries, and particularly over the last two, with an emphasis on those who wielded power and took and implemented decisions, for example, Napoleon and Hitler. Crucially, strategy is not a document, but a practice. It can be understood in terms of what needs to be achieved, the ends, how this will be done, the ways, and which resources will be used to do it, the means, each of which affects the others, both in terms of content and of how it is understood. At the same time, strategy has become a synonym for something very important, or aspiration. Military-focused definitions, as in the employment of battles to gain the end of war, or the art of distributing and applying military means to fulfill the ends of policy, do not address non-military usages of strategy, nor the conflation of policy and strategy that pertains in practice, both for the military and for others. Much current writing, both historical and addressing the present, focuses on the West, and to such an extent that Western commentators and the Western public frequently fail to appreciate the strategic assumptions and values, and hence strategies, of non-Western opponents. That asymmetry has significant consequences in terms of a failure to understand the culturally varying equations of military success, such as the response to casualties. These consequences were visible recently during the conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan. In contrast to the focus on the West, it is necessary also to engage with the Asian dimension and to consider China, India, and Japan not as passive spectators or victims, but either as major players in opposition to other strategic movers or as aspects of the power of those movers. Thus, for example, India was a crucial constituent in Britain's Asian strategy from 1762. Successful expedition from Madras Chennai to Spanish-ruled Manila to 1947, independence. In addition, Japan played a major role in America's East Asian strategy. This was the case not only as an enemy in 1941-5, but also at other times, including passively yet, as a crucial base during the Korean and Vietnam Wars, and also in the current rise of the Chinese peer competitor and the resulting territorial and resource tensions over the East and South China Seas. At the same time as differences, there are important overlaps between Western and non-Western strategies. Thus, for both, divide and rule was the key imperial strategy, and notably in newly conquered territories such as Egypt after Turkish conquest from the Mamluks in 1517. In 1522, the governor defeated a Mamluk insurgency, having bought off the Mamluks' allies among the Arab sheikhs. The important areas for consideration, therefore, are war, the international system, domestic politics, and their interrelated dynamism. The kind of victory that is sought is fundamental to the strategy pursued. Strategy is not viewed exclusively as the process of formulating military goals and the means in every context to implement them. Instead, a total view of strategy, one that encompasses domestic and international strengths, interests, and issues, and that matches much of the popular usage of the term, makes best sense of the war preparation and war making that are the prime dimension of strategy and of the related discussion. Domestic policies and politics are an integral part of pragmatic strategy. Assuaging domestic grievances, for example, makes it easier to ensure support for a foreign war. Thus, strategy is an important aspect of total history, both as component and as consequence. In both international and domestic terms, strategies emerge in response to and in order to forward coalitions of interest. Although the domestic dimension of these coalitions tends to be overlooked or rather underrated in much writing on military strategy, the terms by which these coalitions are formed and reformed become relevant to the process by which strategies are advanced, debated, and reformulated. Indeed, the ability to maintain such coalitions is a key element of strategic activity and a central link between the domestic and international politics and war-making that this book takes as its theme. Arguing that strategic practice is always the expression of an entire culture, a well-founded claim, Edward Luckvack, for example, concluded for the Byzantines that military strategy was subordinated to diplomacy and that the latter focused on playing off enemies against each other, a practice that is more general and that was both cause and consequence of the prioritization central to strategy. More generally, military plans and preparations are frequently a form of insurance policy against the failure of diplomacy and only become really significant in that context. At the same time, such plans and preparations on one or both sides can help cause the failure of diplomacy. The context and process of coalition formation, both domestic and international, and the related goal setting are not static. Thus, for example, war posed a particular challenge to the cohesion of multi-ethnic empires, and notably so in a context of rising nationalism or proto-nationalism. The dynamic character of strategic evolution includes changes in the relationships between the constituent parts of the strategic equations of purpose, force, implementation, and effectiveness. These changes illuminate the present day and offer suggestions for the future. Suggestions for the future are no more than that, although some facets are highly likely, notably strategy continuing, at least in part, to provide an element in the rhetorical politics of power. The analytical approach outlined here is deployed in a consideration of the development of strategy over the last six centuries. I argue that the idea and practice of strategy predated the vocabulary, which is essentially 19th and 20th century. Indeed, modern terminology is not a crucial precondition. It was possible, for example, to have a strategic Hamlet program for civilian control well before the formal use of that term during America's Vietnam War. Irrespective of vocabulary, the idea and practice of strategy contributed to what would subsequently be described as strategic culture, a central concept for this book, albeit one that is not fixed in institutional forms. The idea of strategic culture, a term employed to discuss the context within which military tasks are shaped, is based on the idea that general beliefs, attitudes, and patterns of behavior were integral to the politics of power, rather than being dependent on the policy circumstances of a particular conjuncture. At the same time, the use of this and other concepts has to address specific historical contexts, and doing so underlines the important roles of politics and contingency. Indeed, strategic culture is an aspect, both cause and consequence, of what has been presented as great strategic rivalries. This book seeks to develop these ideas in a dynamic consideration of key conflicts in the past, major issues in the present, and the strategic development of several leading powers. Allowing for significant variations across the world, conflicts and states can be presented as typical of a particular period of conflict and international relations, the two treated as linked but different, and yet also as being understood in terms of domestic realities, notably the particular identity and specific interests of dynasties, peoples, countries, and states. As such, this book will contribute to an understanding of international relations and of the extent to which neither these relations nor the pursuit of military goals were distinct from domestic policies. Moreover, attitudes towards conflict or the means for conflict, such as conscription and popular mobilization, cannot be separated from the discussion of the domestic sphere. Introduction: The Struggle for Power. Definitions. There are major and persistent problems with defining strategy. Historically, strategic decision-makers kept being influenced by and kept taking into account a vast range of developing factors, including the extent to which they were themselves groping towards an understanding of strategy as a concept. Undermining any precise definition, there was no coherent set of factors influencing these decision-makers. Instead, there was a varied inclusion of politics, domestic as well as international. Moreover, while the non-military tools of implementation, such as diplomacy and economic pressure, could be very important, they were not constant in their character and impact. Analyzing how strategy was influenced and made helps to explain the difficulty of arriving at a consistently applied definition. Definition is sometimes fast-forwarded by reference to Clausewitz, but partly because the range of any discussion should be at least global in aspiration, it is probably best not to write in the shadow of Clausewitz. This is even more the case now than in the past because, notably in the light of developments since 1945, Western-centric approaches to military matters and history no longer appear so helpful on a global scale. Clausewitz, furthermore, understood that war is dynamic and keeps changing its character over time, and that his work should not be taken as doctrine. Indeed, the strategic assumptions of any theorist, however abstract, only hold good in specific contexts, and these contexts change, making the theory more or less relevant. Theorists try to generalize from specifics, but their approach is inherently flawed unless their theory is so resistant to exception that it becomes a law, which is not likely in the field of strategy. Issues over definition arise not solely because of, first, the problematic nature of the standard Western-centric approach to war and its analysis, and second, the absence of the use of the term for most of history, although the latter is a potentially important issue. There is also the relationship with other possible classifications and/or typologies of strategy, most obviously grand strategy, a term favored by some commentators from the 1920s, but also applied to earlier periods. The concept of grand strategy leads to a contrasting of policy planning in the shape of grand strategy with implementation in that of strategy. However, this is not a helpful contrasting of what in practice was and is generally a continuum or overlap. The two categories are easier to define as separate than to practice as separate, a situation that is more generally the case. In addition, the application of the understanding of strategy in particular circumstances poses questions that underline the problem with the otherwise apparently attractive concept of the optimum strategy. Moreover, the challenge of the task, notably its immediacy, does not always lend itself to such an optimization, as in the following exchange from the satirical James Bond film Casino Royale. "What's the strategy, sir?" "Get us out of here as soon as possible." The latter from Bond. In such cases, the strategy, the operation, and the tactics all run together very rapidly. Wayne Lee pointed out that most think they intuitively know the difference between strategy, operations, and tactics, but that, in practice, there are many definitions. For Lee, strategy refers to the deployment of resources and forces on a national scale and the identification of key objectives, territorial or otherwise, that operations are then designed to achieve. Operations are defined as campaigns. Adopting a frequently used approach, Thomas Kane and David Lonsdale described strategy as the process that converts military power into policy effect. More generally, strategy is often employed to cover the use of conflict for the purpose of war, or, more usually, a particular war. Strategy, to a degree, focuses on the ability to ensure and sustain a measure of political cohesion and to translate this into military capacity, and not on the pursuit of a particular warfighting style and its implications. The military essentially provide the force to give strategy effect, just as diplomacy is also important to its implementation. There are also understandings of strategy in terms of theories and practices of security, whether or not understood as national strategy. At the same time, this common approach, with its specific understanding, is not sufficient as an account of a more complex reality that entailed and entails both patterns and issues of history, geography, and discourse in the response to conflict and matters of procurement, prioritization, planning, and alliance systems in deciding how best to respond. Yet, there is also the cynical argument, as offered by Dean Eckerson, that every once in a while, you have to give a speech. So you take a look at what you've been doing in the past few months, you write it out, and that's your strategy. This remark can be reconceptualized to argue that strategy is essentially the rationalization, at the time or subsequently, of an events-based practice. To a degree, this is certainly the case, one that draws on thought and argument often, indeed generally being intuitive, not deductive, and one that helps to explain why strategy, therefore, can be such a rationalization. That approach looks towards an emphasis on strategy as inherently political, in that this rationalization can be seen as a political process. Separately, an events-based practice or emergent strategy provides more flexible possibilities, and notably in the face of the discovery of a disruptive enemy strategy. The approach offered by Lee, Kane, Lonsdale, and many others downplays any alternative to a distinctive military character to strategy, and this is an approach which needs to be addressed explicitly. Indeed, the function of strategy, if understood as the relationships between ends, ways, and means in power politics, is not necessarily military. Separately, even in the case of conflict, the prioritization in goals and means at the international level is a matter of the foreign policy establishment and not just the military. This establishment is an amorphous body that includes formal institutions and intelligence services, notably foreign ministries, as well as decision makers at the center of government. At the same time, it is unclear why the national scale should always be the key one in studying strategy, as opposed sometimes to an inclusion of the subnational or indeed the supranational. Furthermore, the impact of each of the latter can compromise the autonomy of decision-making at the national scale. Even during the two centuries, or just over, when the term strategy has been employed in English, French, German, Italian, and other languages, and the concept applied, there is much difference, not to say controversy, over its definition, employment, application, and value. Strategy has been taken to refer to the full range of human activity, as in strategic merit and strategic facet. Thus, in 1991, Patricia Crimmin referred to the English Channel's strategic significance, and in doing so drew attention to the multiple character of such significance. Invasion threat, line of defense, prison wall, escape route. In this context, strategic geography is another pertinent term. At the same time as the vocabulary around strategy, especially the ubiquitous use of the adjective strategic, began to expand in an inflationary manner in the late 20th century, the number of traps around terminology began to increase. Goals, methods, and outcomes all play a role in definitions of strategy and in the application of these definitions, but so also do habit, inclination, institutional practice, and personal preference. This leads to a very varied situation. Indeed, readers of journals might be forgiven for confusion when the same issue can contain pieces on grand strategy and military strategy, as well as reference to strategic engagement. Moreover, alongside different usages come their ready juxtaposition, as in an editorial in The Times of the 5th of December 2018 on the European Union. As a rules-based institution with complex decision-making processes, it lacks the capacity to act strategically. In any case, strategic action requires a capacity to deliver compromises that may be easier for strong governments than weak governments. In this case, the context is presented as inherent to the process of strategy making. In addition, strategy can be seen, for example, as a path rather than a plan for implementation. Indeed, alongside those who seek precision in the analysis, there is, in practice, a level of activity and energy that is far less focused. This includes the idea of a grand strategic impulse rather than simply a plan, with any plan sometimes being a matter of sticking a series of operational possibilities or even tactics together. Much of the current discussion pays no attention to military issues. Thus, in 2016, there were over 56,000 entries on Amazon.com for strategy under business and money. Indeed, strategy is a buzzword in the field of management and economics, one frequently employed alongside terms such as managing and directing. Business strategy ranges from which products to sell on which markets to more complex and varied topics, including quality and environmentalism. There is also strategic communications as a term for information operations, propaganda, and public relations. In 2016, conservative Eurosceptic MP Steve Baker boasted of having used Robert Greene's book, The 33 Strategies of War, to help win the referendum on leaving the European Union. This book set out to provide a guide to everyday life informed by the military principles in war. The banal and facile but best-selling book provided what it termed offensive and defensive strategies. It followed Greene's The 48 Laws of Power and his The Art of Seduction. As instances of the widespread use of military imagery and of strategy in that context, in 2018, Facebook created a war room in its Silicon Valley headquarters in order to fight misinformation ahead of the US midterm elections. That December in Britain, the director of the Police Foundation complained that because of the system of local police forces rather than a national force, fraud is a third of all crime, but there is no national strategy for dealing with it. The tendency to treat strategy as akin to an adjective, describing a process to confront a dangerous issue, a process involving serious consideration and difficult planning, is readily apparent, as in Prime Minister David Cameron's account in 2015 of his drawing up a strategy for tackling hate language. Separately, Alan Downey has profitably used the concept of polemical strategy. Thus, on the 11th of October 2018, President Trump very much employing military terminology, warned of an onslaught of migrants reaching the Mexican border with the United States and threatened to send the army to defend the border, subsequently doing so. There was no onslaught and no need to employ the army. Polemical strategy overlaps with rhetorical strategy. Linked to this, but also separate, there is the concept of strategic narratives, both positive and critical, and covering areas both military and non-military. Thus, in the case of Anglo-American intervention in Afghanistan and Iraq in the 2000s, there were narratives advanced to explain policy, including opposition to terrorism and, in contrast, stabilization. Strategy, understandably, is usually discussed by military historians in terms of war winning. That, however, is to operationalize it in terms of military activity. In practice, strategy, whether military or non-military, and in the former case, whether or not focused on war, is both a process of defining interests, understanding problems, and determining goals, and a product of this process. A ready separation of the two may be attractive in conceptual terms, but does not match the interactions that occur. Moreover, the salience of politics in the process helps make the concept of an apolitical national strategy implausible, as well as encouraging an emphasis on outcomes rather than inputs. Strategy, however, is not the details of the plans by which goals are implemented by military means. These are the operational components of strategy, to employ another, later, term in the shape of operational. There is an important element of variety in the understanding of strategy, including national difference and, separately, change through time. McCubbin Owens, an American commentator, observed in 2014, "Strategy is designed to secure national interests and to attain the objectives of national policy by the application of force or threat of force. Strategy is dynamic, changing as the factors that influence it change. This dynamism clearly extends to the definition and use of strategy." Strategic culture. Differences over definition, application, and impact extend to related concepts, notably that of strategic culture. Although controversial, the latter concept provides a context within which strategy and statecraft, which in some respects is the same, can be approached. This is noticeably so for cases where there was no relevant vocabulary of strategy or institutional culture and practice. Strategic culture is employed to discuss the context within which military tasks were and are shaped. This concept owes much to a 1977 report on Soviet strategic ideas by Jack Snyder for the American RAND Corporation. Written for a specific audience, the concept of strategic culture drew on George Kennan's influential analysis in his Long Telegram from Moscow of the 22nd of February, 1946, and on his Mr. X article in the American periodical Foreign Affairs in April 1947, which made the strategy of containment more public. The concept provided a way to help explain the Soviet Union, a government system and political culture for which sources were manipulated for propaganda reasons and accurate reports were few and problematic. This response to the Soviet Union prefigured that to communist China. States aside, the notion of strategic culture is also very valuable for leaders who did not commit much to paper. This was not only the case for figures in the distant past, but also for many more recent counterparts, such as President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who did not like to commit to paper, in part due to his personality, but also for reasons of accountability, as with his verbal approval to implement unrestricted submarine warfare against Japan after its attack on Pearl Harbor. The idea of explaining and discussing a system, in whole and parts, in terms of a culture captured not only the social and cultural construction and contextualization of power politics, but also the role of established patterns of thought. Moreover, the concept drew on the notion of bounded rationality, a term coined by Herbert Simon, an American economist and decision theorist who sought to emphasize the limitations to rational decision-making. The assumption of classical economists, which was also in line with contemporary beliefs about people and leaders, was that they pursued rational goals and means. In contrast, in the aftermath of the horrors of the first half of the century, Simon posed the idea that people's rationality is bounded by what they know and how they perceive ideological attachments and psychological factors. What the bounds are and how they are influenced or changed are matters of debate and research to this day. While there is a great deal of disagreement on this, the high tide of unquestioning belief in rational humanity has passed. The classical paradigm remains attractive to some theorists for modeling purposes, but has generally been discarded in favor of some kind of bounded rationality idea. There is an obvious relevance for contemporary strategy and its discussion. The classic model of rational strategy making outlined in the 19th century no longer exists in the same way, although the idea of an optimal solution seeks to provide a different route. In addition, as another constraint on rationality, at the same time as increasingly sophisticated quantitative methods are producing more reliable data for decision making, coming from many more different perspectives and sources, there is an inability to sift, process, and codify data in time. That provides different boundaries for decision makers. The shifting nature of contexts operates in a number of respects. For example, the notion of distinctive generational experiences is valuable not only with reference to contrasting understandings of the possibilities and practice of strategy, but also in terms of the changing character of strategic culture. These experiences could readily become politically charged, both at the time and in subsequent discussion, as with the link between the idea of a nation in arms and republicanism in France from the 1790s. Separately, both for religious and for secular societies, there were differing accounts of providential systems of behavior and should be predictable outcomes. The implication was that a correct understanding would lead to an assured outcome. This approach was to be all too common in the discussion that followed the introduction of a formal language of strategy from the late 18th century. The implication was at once reassuring and misleading, and contributes to the current idea of the lost art of strategy, a notion that in part rests on a supposed prelapsarian past linked to a theory of decline. The delay in the development of the term strategy reflects, for some commentators, conceptual and institutional limitations affecting the prior understanding of strategy. However, in his study of strategy before the term, in the case of Russia, an empire whose extensive territories from the 17th century, from the Pacific to the Baltic, entailed a range of commitments and opportunities, John P. LeDun addressed the possible criticism that he presented nothing but virtual strategy, in which the author attributes to the Russian political elite a vision they never had, and in language they would not have used. LeDun added a helpful definition of what he termed grand strategy, namely, an integrated military, geopolitical, economic, and cultural vision. That, indeed, is a worthwhile definition, but without any need to add the word grand to strategy. Ironically, this term looks back to the late 18th century use in France of the term grand tactics, which was a term usually employed to discuss what would today be referred to as the operational level. Focusing on the significance of elite views in the past entails a welcome grounding in particular historical contexts, and thus a rejection of any ahistorical, non-cultural, non-realist framework for analyzing strategic choices. Instead, how an elite saw and presented both itself and its identity and interests comprised, and continues to comprise, the most important component of strategic choice, and thereby of resulting outcomes. Indeed, strategic consequences were central to an important feedback mechanism in which elites either came to reconceptualize their assumptions, those constituting their strategic culture, or did not do so. This process is important to the contemporary and later evaluation of strategic assumptions. This focus on elites has been broadened in order to discuss how nations see their roles and objectives. That presentation of strategic culture is also an approach which covers the inherent political character of strategy and strategic choice, because these choices were contested as they were shaped and reshaped. Institutions and thinkers. Compared to the formal institutional processes of strategic discussion and planning in recent decades, notably its military context as a supposedly distinct activity, strategy prior to the 19th century appears, in at least that context, as at best limited and ad hoc, and as lacking both well-developed structure and doctrine to match an empirical process of learning and ideas. Thus, in the War of American Independence, British strategy in North America was essentially created by the field commanders rather than by the cabinet or by the Secretary of State for America, Lord George Germain. This was the case even though setting the strategy was in his domain, and he was a former general and had had experience of counterinsurgency warfare. That situation, however, does not mean that strategy was unfit for purpose. Moreover, in the case of Christian Europe, then the West, it has been claimed by Peter Wilson, a specialist in German forces, that general staffs of a type emerged during the 30 Years' War, with the staff designed to assist the commander and maintain communications with the political center. Such staffs evolved from the personal assistants initially paid by the general himself, but they generally remained very limited in numbers and method. Indeed, applied then, the term general staff may well be highly misleading, not least as it looks towards the 19th century. In addition to the 30 Years' War, other episodes have attracted attention. For example, it has been argued that, under the direction of Field Marshal Count Franz Moritz Lacy, Austria, at war with Prussia during the Seven Years' War, established what became an effective proto-general staff. Such an argument necessarily puts earlier developments in the 30 Years' War in the shade and or implies a process of episodic development. Logistics, a key element in the planning of campaigns in both centuries, certainly involved staff work. In his History of the Late War in Germany, Henry Lloyd, who had served in the Seven Years' War, claimed, "It is universally agreed upon that no art or science is more difficult than that of war." Yet, by an unaccountable contradiction of the human mind, those who embrace this profession take little or no pains to study it. They seem to think that the knowledge of a few insignificant and useless trifles constitute a great officer. This opinion is so general that little or nothing else is taught at present in any army whatever. That account was substantially correct as far as formal education was concerned. However, Lloyd underrated the very important method of learning on the job, notably by example, experience, and discussion. This was seen not only with training, but also in the public sphere, for example with pamphlet and newspaper debates during and after particular operations, discussing their wisdom in conception and execution. The limited institutional character to military education and command practice for most of history can be presented as having lessened the possibility of moving on from strategic culture to strategy, or at least strategic planning. Conversely, the absence of a mechanism for the creation and dissemination of institutional wisdom on strategy may well have ensured that the body of assumptions and norms referred to as strategic culture was instead more effective, indeed more normative. This body of assumptions and norms affected both strategic thinkers and strategic actors. And in turn, they each sustained assumptions. Differentiating strategic culture from strategy in terms of firm distinctions is not in practice overly helpful, but the attempt can capture the extent to which there are contrasts in emphasis. The arguments and role of strategic thinkers, generally presented as military theorists, whether they, like Lloyd, Clausewitz, Jomini, Mahan, Douay, Fuller, and Little Hart, served in the military, or whether they did not, attract the attention of intellectuals, both military and non-military. This is particularly so in the case of academics who write on the military and who tend to seek intellectual assessments of war. Notably, this is so for a focus on Clausewitz, as he was, and is, taken by some to help in some way explain and characterize subsequent Prussian and then German military success, as well as, in his writings, to provide a benchmark for the effectiveness of past states and of other thinkers, and indeed to capture essential characteristics of warfare. In practice, such thinkers might have been largely irrelevant or relevant only insofar as they captured and focused general nostrums and current orthodoxies, and therefore served in some way to validate them. It is instructive to note that in the case of China, the state for much of history prior to the 19th century, with the most developed literary treatment of war, there is scant evidence of the use of texts for guidance. Indeed, the Kangxi Emperor, a ruler far more successful as a military leader than his contemporary, Louis XIV of France, let alone Napoleon, allegedly declared the military classics, such as the works of Sun Tzu, worthless, and references to these classics in Chinese military documents were rare. That emperor faced a variety of serious military challenges, foreign and domestic, and surmounted all of them. Strategic practice was long-standing in the Chinese case. The marginality of explicitly military thinkers can also be considered for other states, including even Clausewitz's Prussia. Alternatively, these thinkers can in part be profitably presented as an instance of the rhetoric of power, an aspect of power that was as significant to contemporaries as its analysis, indeed far more so. As a result of this formulation of strategy, domestic attitudes, policies, and politicians can be as significant in the understanding of interests and in the formulation and execution of strategy as their military counterparts, again, indeed generally far more so. Thus, in the War on Terror in the 2000s and 2010s, measures taken to try to secure the support of the bulk of the Muslim population of countries threatened by terrorism, such as Britain, are as germane as the use of force against new or suspected terrorists. Deterrence is an aspect of both. Conversely, an ISIS manual, apparently written in 2014, that set out plans for a centralized, self-sufficient state included the establishment of an army, but also of military schools to create further generations of fighters, as well as bureaucratic planning, covering health, education, industry, propaganda, and resource management. With its broad approach, this was another iteration of the revolutionary strategies outlined in the 20th century, notably in national liberation struggles. A key point throughout the history of strategy is that it is the activity, not the word nor the text, that is the basis of examination and analysis. And an emphasis on activity makes it easier to make comparisons across time, space, and cultures. Treating the existence of strategy as highly problematic for a period when the term is absent mistakes the absence of an articulated school of strategic thinking for the lack of strategic awareness. At the same time, there is the issue of shaping into a false coherence the often disparate discussion, limited planning, and isolated and frequently indirect pointers of evidence that exist. This problem underlines the additional difficulties of aligning the situation in one state, in one period, with that in other states, in the same or other periods. This is always a task for which historians lack the enthusiasm of social scientists, and one that, separately, brings to the fore the problems entailed in the search for what might be termed a unified theory of strategy. A key element in encouraging caution in the pursuit of a narrow definition was the lack of any unpacking of strategy and policy, a lack which reflected the absence of any institutional body specifically for strategic planning and execution, and also the repeated tendency in politics, government, and political discussion to see what could subsequently be differentiated as strategy and policy as, in fact, one and necessarily so. The chronological background. Even though the terms of strategy have not been in use for most of history, the concepts of strategic thinking have been around since humans engaged in organized conflict, while the institutional body for strategic planning and execution was the ruler, with the generals part of this body as they carried out the ruler's orders. This situation became more apparent when it was a question of large-scale organized conflict. The first states that have been widely discussed as having a strategy are those of classical Greece. The discussion of strategy in the classical period is long-standing. If it conventionally began with Thucydides writing on the strategy of the Peloponnesian War between Athens and Sparta, in which he participated, it has continued, as with Hans de Bruch's Die Strategie des Pericles erläutert durch die Strategie Friedrich der Großen, the strategy of Pericles clarified by the strategy of Frederick the Great. Thucydides began an approach to strategy that became dominant in the modern world. However, a broader and far older approach can be found in Homer's Iliad, with its gripping account of the central roles of honor and revenge in the causes, pursuit, and course of the Trojan War. Moreover, this approach linked the world of men to that of the gods in a fashion that made sense to the Greeks. Each was seen as a warring world. Modern work has offered much insight into this period. Paul Rahe's The Grand Strategy of Classical Sparta, The Persian Challenge, related military activity, notably in the 5th century BCE, to what Rahe presented as a strategy of life and living, notably the customs and laws that constituted the background of politics, both domestic and foreign. The retention of troops at home to deal with any revolt by helots or slaves was seen as a key element. Victor Davis Hanson directed attention to Athens. Notions of honor and status, and therefore revenge, were significant in the rivalry between the two powers in the Peloponnesian War. The claim that because there was no term for strategy, Rome lacked strategic thinking fails to give sufficient weight to the lasting need to prioritize possibilities and threats, and in response, to allocate resources and to decide how to use them. This is a need at all levels, but one that is particularly apparent for far-flung states, such as the Roman Empire. The earlier three Punic Wars between Carthage and Republican Rome have been profitably discussed in terms of what are presented as contemporary views of strategy, with the latter seen to depend on long-term planning and a good perception of geographical relationships. The location of fortifications is another instance of the latter, and not only by the Romans. Alfred Thayer Mahan, the American theorist of command of the sea, was influenced by the German historian Theodor Mommsen, who in his Römische Geschichte, History of Rome, presented Roman naval power as playing a crucial strategical role against Carthage in the Second Punic War, which was a valuable counter to the operational level analysis of concentrating on Hannibal's campaigning in Italy. Mommsen also treated Julius Caesar as the epitome of a strategist statesman. An application of modern international relations theory was a significant element in Arthur Eckstein's Mediterranean Anarchy, interstate war, and the rise of Rome. Eckstein explained Rome's success in the multipolar anarchy of the Mediterranean in part in terms of its ability to understand and manage the resulting web of relationships. Thus, strategy entailed adroit prioritization. Conversely, alongside a presentation of Roman strategy in terms of modern concepts of defense has come, as with Greece, a stress on factors such as honor and revenge. That emphasis, however, does not negate the existence of strategy. Instead, it underlines its complexity, a point also seen with China, for example, in the relationship between fortifications, borders, and the perception of the structure of the universe. Strategy has also been discerned in the case of other pre-modern civilizations. Byzantium, the Eastern Roman Empire, which lasted until 1453, is a clear example. It has been suggested that, under incessant pressure from other powers, Byzantium could not afford to wage wars of attrition nor to seek decisive battles. Instead, it is argued that Byzantium sought to ally with the tribal enemies of its current opponent, and that the tendency was to avoid battle. Fortifications for Byzantium were part of a larger strategy in which tribute payment played a role. There was also a relevant contemporary literature from Byzantium, some of which excited interest from the 18th century. As far as medieval Western Europe is concerned, sources are few, and there is little or no theoretical literature on strategy, which indeed did not exist as an explicit concept. The standard chronicle narratives of war are of scant help because the contemporary chroniclers were clerical outsiders and simply gave narratives of campaigns or accounts of hand-to-hand encounters, as with treatments of the Norman conquest of England in 1066. They generally had little grasp of the thinking and planning behind activities. Medieval Western European strategy existed, but has to be worked out from what commanders did and not, on the whole, from documents in which it was discussed. Although there are valuable records, for example, from Peter IV of Aragon. Medieval leaders knew what they wanted to do, but there was no school or forum to produce a dialectic, and each leader chose his methods. Despite a contrasting language, this is essentially the case today, and is so whatever the theory of strategy. Features of medieval strategy in Christendom, the Islamic world, India, China, and Japan included logistics, concentric advances, and defensive strategy in the shape of the location of fortifications. Modern writers have gone to much effort to discuss medieval strategy in Western Europe and have done so with profit, not least when assessing the wider context of the choices between battle, siegecraft, and raiding, choices indeed that were relevant across the world and for much of military history. Indeed, they reach to the present. This discussion has helped illuminate particular conflicts and individual rulers. The choices made in targets and methods have been tackled, for example, why the Second Crusade attacked Damascus and not Aleppo in 1148, an analysis that presciently warns about being misled by modern-day calculations of strategic interest that cannot be reconciled with 12th-century realities. In invading France in the 1340s and 1350s during the Hundred Years' War, Edward III of England sought to wear down his enemy by ravaging the countryside. This was an instance of strategy as, at least in part, the extension of tactical thinking, but also of using war to pay for itself, as well as of demonstrating to subjects of the enemy that their overlord could not protect them, so they'd better change sides. The same goals and processes were seen in other areas, for example India, including in the 18th century, as new polities were formed alongside the decline of the Mughal Empire. Repeatedly, the political context was crucial, including during the Anglo-French Wars. When, in the mid-1430s, the English lost the support of Duke Philip of Burgundy, their defeat in France became inevitable, as hitherto the fundamentals of their strategy in the 15th century had rested on exploiting divisions within France, and notably poor relations between the Crown and Burgundy. There was a similar pattern in India, with a pursuit of conciliation in order to incorporate new territories, as well as a struggle over resources, not least by blockading forts so as to drive them to surrender. An impression of control was crucial in India and elsewhere. Conflict could reflect a failure of strategy in the shape of an inability on one or both parts to manage the impression of power adequately. This was made more significant by the lack of cohesion in many political groups, however defined. This lack of cohesion could be found in ruling groups, including royal lineages, tribal networks, and whatever might be defined as a state. The practicalities of warfare, of feeding armies and making sure they could move, were dominant requirements. Thus, scorched earth was a method, at once tactical, operational, and strategic, that hindered advances by others and that acted as a deterrent. Scorched earth was employed, for example, by the Safavids against the Ottoman-Turkish invasion of Iraq and Iran in 1514, and its success helps explain why the Safavids were mistaken when they exposed themselves at Shaldaran to a battle in which they were to be defeated by Selim I. However, he was unable to exploit the victory. Scorched earth also worked for the Crimean Tatars in thwarting Russian invasions in the 1680s. In the case of crusading warfare, Saladin, in 1187, lured the poorly commanded army of the Kingdom of Jerusalem into a waterless area where he could fight on his terms and destroyed his opponents at Hattin. Moreover, in part due to the supply issue, Richard I of England, a key figure in the Third Crusade, soon after advised a strategy of attacking Egypt, which ruled Palestine and Jerusalem, rather than going for Jerusalem itself. This was a strategy followed in the 13th century, notably by Louis IX of France. Egypt was seen as the key component of the Ayyubid Empire, and two major expeditions were mounted in 1218-21 and 1248-50, both of which were initially successful, only to fail catastrophically, especially the latter. Subsequently, after the loss of the Holy Land in 1291, some proposals for its recovery involving economic blockades of Egypt as a first step were quite sophisticated, although European rulers were not able to cooperate sufficiently in order to implement the strategy. More generally, modern ideas of what was strategically sensible should only be applied with care in judging crusading strategy. Political and particularly religious factors came into play. A long-standing form of strategy, one readily understandable today and seen in the Middle Ages, for example, with the Christian Reconquista in Spain and Portugal, was to anchor conquest by means of new settlement. This was also a persistent aspect of Chinese strategy when operating in the steppe. It was seen, moreover, with the Russian advances into Siberia, Ukraine, and Central Asia, and with American operations in the interior. For outside Europe, there has been particular scholarly interest in Mongol strategy in the 13th century. Force conservation was a major goal for the Mongols. The Mongol tsunami method of conquest involved invading and devastating a large region, but then withdrawing and holding only a small section of territory. As a result, troops were not tied down in garrison duty, while the creation, by devastation, of a buffer zone made it impossible to attack them and also weakened the enemy's resources. Then there was another surging forward, again like a wave. As a consequence, the Mongols were able to fight on multiple fronts without overextending themselves. At the same time, Mongol strategic culture developed, notably making a transition in the 13th century to city-taking conflict, especially in China. This transition was linked to administrative reforms that permitted a different level of organization and sustaining forces. In part, this process entailed drawing on conquered regions, particularly China. As a result, a hybridized form of warfare developed, with hybridity seen in strategic, operational, and tactical terms. A different aspect of Mongol effectiveness invites consideration when assessing how best to discuss strategy. If opponents refused to accept terms, the Mongols employed terror, slaughtering many in order to intimidate others. This policy may have increased resistance, but also encouraged surrender. More generally, success won support and maintained cohesion, both important strategic outcomes. Mongol methods were revived by Timur the Lame, later called Tamerlane. A key element of his strategy was that of inheriting the mantle of Chinggis Khan, the most famous Mongol leader. Timur claimed descent from Chinggis, a significant source of legitimacy, although in fact he was not a Chinggisid. Timur married Chinggisid princesses so that he could have the title of Goregan, or son-in-law. Sequential campaigning against a range of targets was crucial to Timur's successful career. In turn, the fall of Timur's and other nomadic empires reflected not so much military limitations as the difficulties of maintaining cohesion. This was not least in the face of frequent succession struggles. In total contrast to the strategic logic of Timur's goals, the Chinese presented their strategy as sustaining a world order of peace that held barbarism at bay. Thus, Zheng He, who led naval expeditions into the Indian Ocean in the early 15th century, erected an explanatory statement. Upon arriving at foreign countries, capture those barbarian kings who resist civilization and are disrespectful, and exterminate those bandit soldiers that indulge in violence and plunder. The ocean route will be safe thanks to this. Western commentary on war, then and subsequently, was an aspect of thought that focused on choices as well as context. In the case of Philip II of Spain, who repeatedly faced major pressures across his far-flung empire, there is disagreement over the quality of his strategic practice. There was certainly tension between the goal of control and the more successful practice of soft power, a practice that included the threat of violence alongside propaganda, patronage, diplomatic initiatives, and economic pressure. The judgments bound up in various uses of the term strategy, including long-term strategy, grand strategy, strategic schizophrenia, and clear and coherent strategic vision, are apparent. Such a discussion, indeed debate, could be held about many other states and episodes. It has been argued, nevertheless, more specifically for the 30 Years' War in Europe, but also for the subsequent European Ancien Régime of 1648 to 1789, that the logistical problems posed by supporting armies made it difficult to pursue a strategy reflecting political war aims, and thus hard to act in accordance with any overall strategy. In practice, there were always political war aims directing the armies, although armies had to move according to logistical constraints. More broadly, choices in force structures and command methods in the early modern period, that of the 16th and 17th centuries, repeatedly reflected the fusion of strategy and policy, as they often arose from fundamental assumptions about the methods best placed to preserve social norms as well as state integrity. This was the key nexus of politics. Similar points can be made for other periods. Fitness for purpose, in terms of capabilities and choices, could be affected by institutional as well as technological changes. Thus, in the 1850s, the coastal offensive dynamic in British planning emphasized the role of the hydrographic office in the development of theatre strategy, and in turn contributed to that dynamic. In marked contrast to the unsuccessful overland French attack on Russia in 1812, the Crimean War focused on Anglo-French naval and amphibious action against Russia, a process greatly aided by the recent development of steam-powered warships. This situation has been seen more recently with the development of institutions for joint warfare and combined operations, institutions that sought to exploit in a systematic fashion the opportunities created by powered landing craft and helicopter-borne troops. As another aspect of fitness for purpose, there was always, once states had developed, a functional strategy, even if it did not have a linguistic or institutional formulation. Since strategy is contextual, highly so, so are its definitions or non-definitions. The 1976 Encyclopedia Britannica noted that the demarcation between strategy as a purely military phenomenon and national strategy of the broader variety became blurred in the 19th century, and even less clear in the 20th. That did not affect the fitness for purpose of the military aspect of strategy. The ownership of strategy. A particular and currently pressing difficulty arises because of the issue of ownership, which is a leading feature in the context of strategic analysis. The wide variation in the use of the term strategy and of the concept in part arises from this very issue, alongside the more commonplace problems stemming from the definition and usage of conceptual terms, and notably of ones that have differing resonances in specific cultural and national contexts. In large part, but far from exclusively, this issue of ownership comes from the determination by and on behalf of militaries to define a sphere of activity and planning that is under their understanding and control, a process that is endorsed by their civilian supporters among commentators. Much of the writing about strategy, indeed, has been driven by or for military thinkers. This context remains relevant today, with strategy and notably because modern militaries in many countries continue to seek a professionalism that both limits the intervention of other branches of government and accordingly enables them to define their role. The Powell Doctrine, in the case of the American military in the 1990s, Colin Powell was chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff from 1989 to 1993, exemplified this point, as did arguments over Anglo-American interventions in Afghanistan and Iraq in the 2000s and 2010s. Alongside areas generally left to the competence of military leaders, especially training, tactics and doctrine, came the determination by these leaders, a determination very publicly asserted, to maintain a key role in procurement, operations and policy. Annexing the last in terms of what is defined as strategy and limiting government to a more anodyne and general field termed policy serves this goal. More positively, military leaders who insist upon clarity of roles, terms, missions and responsibilities are in part motivated by a suspicion that the political leaders do not truly understand what they themselves want or what they want done. As a result, this insistence is an effort to force the political leaders to articulate their goals. Sometimes this process is motivated by a sense of professional duty, and sometimes it arises because the political leaders are, appear, or can be presented as incompetent in devising policy and considering strategy. In practice, basing themselves on international and domestic circumstances and criteria, political leaders have frequently already made the decision before they consult the military experts, and consultation is often intended to help justify their decision or simply serves as an aspect of implementation. This is a standard aspect of institutional politics. Similarly, the criticism of civilian leaders can be an attempt to contest blame as well as assert control, one in which politicians in uniform are determined to have their say. The argument on behalf of military independence can certainly be queried, both in specifics and in general. The discussion of strategy is as worthy of attention in terms of this subject as it is with regard to the commonplace division between policy and strategy, although much depends upon an understanding of particular contexts and of institutional cultures. As another instance of accountability, there is the question whether reliance on the argument of military independence is an aspect, very much a self-serving aspect, of what, in 2015, General Nicholas Houghton, the chief of the British General Staff, referred to as military conservatism. This conservatism includes historic funding trends for specific institutions, practices, and weapon systems. Strategic reviews in Britain, with their focus on expenditure on specific military means, build into this approach. The attempt to separate out strategy from policy is, in some respects, not only a question of apparent terminological precision, but also an aspect of this conservatism, as well as being an effort to provide a distinctive military voice in the decision-making process and to try to ensure that this voice has coherence and weight. An instance of a comparable, although different, qualification to the distinction between strategy and policy is that between public and private in the organization of war. The two in practice overlap considerably. Contexts for strategy. Clearly, even if a means versus ends distinction is to be advanced when discussing strategy and policy and the relations between them, ends are in large part set in relation with and to means, while means are conceived of and planned in terms of ends. In addition, from another perspective, strategy was and is conceptualized in terms of strategic culture in the sense of long-term views on both world affairs and domestic political culture, with these views proving a key feature of the belief systems of policymakers, as well as of their psychological drives. To separate out these factors is not only unhelpful as an account of the past, but also puts an emphasis on a precision that is ahistorical as an approach to the past, as well as being only an aspiration for present and future, and a misleading one at that. The argument that American and British policy in the Muslim world in the 2000s was mistaken in its understanding of strategy served apparently to discredit imprecision, which was directly linked to failure in Iraq in the mid-2000s. That failure, however, was not due to imprecision, but instead to a total misreading of the situation there, both political and military, one that exemplifies the point that understanding the nature of a particular conflict, rather than theorizing about war in general, is crucially necessary. Separately, aside from the argument that a lack of coherence in strategy was in fact an appropriate response to complexity, including changing circumstances, the apparent imprecision in the understanding and practice of strategy is, in part, a reflection of the variety of environments in which policy is pursued. Thus, the real character of war varies in detail. It is incumbent upon the strategic planner and operator to understand as fully as possible the nature of the particular war upon which they are embarking. Otherwise, the chances for crafting a successful and appropriate strategy are limited. Separately, the valuable argument that strategy is designed to make war usable by the state so that it can, if need be, use force to fulfill its political objectives also raises a number of issues, not only the distinction, or at least tension, between the use of force and political objectives, but also the role of non-state actors, and the very diversity of state forms and cultures. There is no your original and essential form and dynamic of the state, just as there is none for war. The real interests of a state, whether, for example, they are an increase of dominion, can vary across time, as can the form these interests take, and the emphasis on the kinetic use of force. Far from there being any fixed relationship between war and politics, it is the varied and often flexible nature of the links that helps explain the importance of each to the other. For example, military activity has greatly altered the contours and parameters of the politics that helped cause it, and sometimes of the states and others involved in conflict. In some cases, military activity has also had...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.